I know Raiden and I talked to you quite a bit about money, but today we wanted to change it up some and talk to you about a different way that you can secure your retirement, which is by seeing new things and experiencing new things. And we're going to do that today by talking about art with Jennifer Dasal, who is the curator for the NC Museum of Art.
Yeah, this is this interview that we did, Merce and I, when we started out the interview, we're like, I don't even know that we know anything about art, but we got the referral actually from Laura in our office. And she said, you need to interview her. She said, I've read her book. She goes, I've listened to her podcast. It's just, it's super fun and interesting. And so we said, okay, well, let's have her on the show. And by the end of our podcast, Merce and I both are like, oh man, I want to learn more about art. And she shares a fantastic story about a piece of art that everybody knows about. So you want to make sure you listen to that. And it's just it's a different kind of show, but very interesting. I hope you enjoy. I will ask you to do this before we go into the show, though. If you have the ability, we would certainly appreciate if you have not been able to do so, to give us a 5-star rating and write us a little review. This is mostly on iTunes, but no matter where you listen to us, if you're able to rate us, we would certainly appreciate it. It certainly does help us, but we appreciate every single one of you who listen to the show, and we hope you enjoy our interview with Jennifer Dasal. We welcome everybody to our podcast today. Today is one of those podcasts that we're doing on lifestyle. We have really broken the podcast down into three categories: financial, legacy, and the other's lifestyle. And I kind of put this one under the lifestyle column. And what we wanted to do is talk about something that's right here in Raleigh that a lot of people would be able to benefit from, and maybe not understand completely right now, but after talking to our guests, maybe we'll have a much better understanding of the art world. And so we went out and we wanted to find an art expert. And so we do have one with us today. We've got Jennifer Dasal. Thank you so much, Jennifer, for coming on the podcast with us today.
Thank you for having me. This is great. I'm excited to be here.
Well, good. Well, Jennifer has written a book, and am I saying it right when I say ArtCurious?
Correct. Yes, yeah. ArtCurious.
Yeah. So she's got a book on that. We'll talk about that a little bit more as we go into the conversation. But, you know, it's interesting that there's many different aspects that maybe some of us don't understand about art. And so we're excited to be able to talk with you today, Jennifer. So I'm going to turn it over to Merce, and Merce is going to get us started on our first question or so here.
Yeah. Once again, thanks for joining us, Jennifer. So I was reading into your book, and at the beginning, you have this introduction pretty much stating that you weren't always into art. Mm-hmm. And I think a lot of people can relate to that. I'm not that much into art. The museum is right down the road, and I think I've only been there once in my, you know, very long time being in the area. So what gravitated you towards art? What was like that changing thing that happened in your life that said, hey, I actually really like this stuff?
That's such a great question. And I completely I understand where you're coming from, because as I say in the book, it's exactly where I used to be. So I didn't have any real art experience growing up. It wasn't something that was of great interest to my family. So I didn't go to museums very often, except maybe the occasional school field trip. And I don't particularly have a lot of artistic experience myself. So me trying to actually create art did not go very well for me as well. But I do remember that when I was entering my freshman year in college, back in California, which is where I'm originally from, I needed to have something to kind of check that humanities requirement off of my graduation requirement list. And I've always been kind of a type A person. So I wanted to make sure that I could get a lot of the requirements out of the way as quickly as possible to make sure that I could get done and graduate on time. So I knew that I wanted to get this requirement done, and everything I wanted to do, like English classes, music classes, things like that, they were all completely booked by the time I got around to registering for them. And I tried probably about 5 or 6 different courses, electives, to get into, and could not do it. And I was so frustrated, and I felt like there was really no option for me. So I went to a course counselor, and the course counselor basically said, this is not a big deal. We're just gonna find you a class, and you're just gonna take it. It's gonna be great. And she sat down with a physical book, a course catalog. So it was like this thick, it was super big. And she just said, it's great. We're just gonna find something that is open for you. And she opened to the letter A, just basically started at the beginning. And so she came upon art history fairly quickly. And she said, this is a popular class. A lot of people take your introduction to art history, kind of beginning with ancient art, going all the way to probably the early Renaissance. And she said, let's just see if there's still room. And of course there was. And before I could even really say anything, I found myself already registered into this class, you know, without me saying so and being any interested at all. So I found myself in art history and I was very angry about it. I really was not thrilled and not excited at all to take this class. And a couple of weeks later, I realized that the joke was kind of on me, because the more I started learning about art, the more I got completely drawn in into the backstories. So why we create as people, what it means for us to make works of art, you know, the backstory behind the artists, what inspired them. And I couldn't get enough. And officially about 2 years later, I changed my major to art history. And it's kind of, that's how it all began for me. It was accidental, really.
That's awesome. Isn't that crazy how that some one little thing can kind of shape your future? Because yeah. I had a very similar situation. I was doing finance in college, but I didn't know there's so many different avenues that you can take in finance. I didn't know which one I wanted to do. And then I stumbled on this personal finance class. And now that's what I've been doing ever since. You know, so one little thing can shape, you know, the next 10, 20, 30 years of your life. It's pretty cool.
It is. And it's fun to be open to stuff like that and just kind of let the things that you're interested in find you, which is very cool.
So yeah. We know that you're a book writer and we'll talk about that a little bit too. But so I know that where you work, you're called the art curator. So could you describe what that means? Like somebody who's in that position, what that actually entails?
Sure. That's a really good question. I get it all the time because I feel like it's one of those jobs that people don't quite know exactly what a curator is. And I completely understand it's not the most straightforward job, but basically we're the caretakers of works of art within our particular departments. So at the North Carolina Museum of Art, for example, I am the curator of modern and contemporary art. So it's a little hazy, but basically it's like I specialize in 20th and 21st century art. So what it means to be the curator of that is that I take all of the work that's in the collection within that realm, that time period, and I am the person that helps to do things like contextualize it through wall labels. I give lectures about it. If there's an exhibition, I put it together, whether or not it's coming from the museum internally, like we create the exhibition and then put it on display, or if it's something that we're borrowing from another institution, it comes to us on loan, then I then learn about all the works of art, decide where it goes on the wall in conjunction with our design department. And then everything that you would possibly learn about the works of art, so wall labels, catalog information, any public tours, then that's a lot of content that I'll be creating. So basically I write about the art, I talk about the art, I help decide where it's gonna go up on the wall, and all of the kind of pertinent back information with that.
That's awesome. I got one follow-up question. And I know, you know, just on that point. So you wrote this book, mm-hmm. ArtCurious, and in on the front of the book, it says, stories of the unexpected, slightly odd, and strangely wonderful in art history. And I'm just curious, could you, like, when you think about stories around art, is anything come to mind that you go, okay, let me give you a strange story, or here, let me give you a little bit of background. Do you have anything like that that you could share with us?
Absolutely. So I'll give you the backstory to why I created the podcast Art Curious in the first place, which then led to the book Art Curious, which is about 4 or 5 years ago, I was on a business trip for the North Carolina Museum of Art. And I was going to meet an artist in, of all places, in France to talk about an exhibition that we were doing together. And so before I met with this artist, I had a few days available to just hang out in Paris while I was waiting to meet up with this person.
So basically, and what you're saying is this job has very difficult aspects of it, having to travel to France. Yeah.
Terrible. Somebody has to do it. The perks are just non-existent. So I took a couple days just to be in Paris and to immerse myself in the museum scene there. And so I thought, well, you know, it's going to be really nice. I've been to Paris maybe a couple of times prior to that point in my life. I'd only been to the Louvre Museum once. And so I thought, oh, it'll be great to go to the Louvre. I would love to see the Mona Lisa again, because I think that's the first thing that a lot of people, if you think about the Louvre Museum, you think, oh, that's where Mona Lisa is, the most famous work of art, probably of all time, really, for most of us. And the first thing that I think of whenever I think of Mona Lisa is that when I was in that kind of freshman year art history class, my professor was talking about what was great about Leonardo da Vinci and his works of art, especially Mona Lisa. And at the very end of her lecture about this work of art, she said, you can go see it. It's at the Louvre. If you end up in France, check it out. And she paused for what felt like maybe 5 seconds. And then she said, and if you don't make it, it's not a big deal, because the Mona Lisa that you see isn't the real one. The real one is somewhere else. We don't know. It might be in the basement, or maybe it was stolen. And she rattles off this very quick, what seemed to me to be a very conspiracy theory kind of story. And it really shook me, because this was from a professor who didn't seem to be someone who was interested in that kind of story. And she seemed very straightforward and level-headed, and it just seemed so bizarre. So while I was on this business trip, I did indeed go to the Louvre. I saw the Mona Lisa, and I thought, why would she think that? And that really just made me pick up a book and start reading about the fact that Mona Lisa has been stolen multiple times. The first time she was stolen, it is potentially that she was stolen by a known art forger and an art theft who were working in conjunction with one another. She was then stolen again during World War II, and there is a known copy of the work of art that is supposed to be so close in resemblance that the Louvre themselves even call it nearly identical. So it really just led me to wonder, how come more people don't know these very weird stories about this most famous work of art? And that was what inspired me to do my podcast, and what has led me to where we are right now with this book. Very weird.
No, that's an awesome story. Actually, while we're on it, because I don't really know the story of the Mona Lisa, and I imagine there's plenty out there, that what about the Mona Lisa? I know it was I don't know who it was painted by. Who was it painted by?
Leonardo da Vinci.
So, right. So it's in the, what about the
early 16th century.
What about that painting, and that specific painting, makes it so desirable to steal or to forge? What makes it so the highlight of going to see the Louvre?
Yeah. Well, I think for most people, the fact that it's a highlight is just because it's so iconic and so recognizable. Like, even if you are not interested in art, you still have a mental picture of what the Mona Lisa looks like and who the Mona Lisa is, because you've seen it imitated and parodied everywhere. It's been in Looney Tunes. It's been on The Simpsons. It's everywhere. So you go, I think, for a lot of people, just to be able to say, oh, I saw the real deal. One of the reasons that it's become so iconic is actually the fact that it was stolen. So, very long story short, the Mona Lisa as a work of art was important during the Renaissance. It was by Leonardo da Vinci, one of the most famous artists of that period, and probably of the last millennia, really. And but it wasn't this totally idealized, wonderful work of art that everybody knew and loved at that point. It wasn't until probably the late 19th century that people started getting really interested in the work of art. And part of it does have to do with the fact that she has that weird kind of like half smile, that very mysterious smile that everybody likes to talk about. And that became a big deal in the 19th century, when a lot of writers and poets started really kind of waxing rhapsodic about this work of art. So she had this long period of being interesting, but not super famous. And then when the work of art was stolen the first time in 1911, it was gone for almost 2.5 years. And there was this thought that it would never return. And then when the work of art was finally returned, as far as history has told us, that was when it just became this pop culture sensation. And it's really never faded since then. It has had a really long, interesting history because of it.
Very good. So could you tell us a little bit about, maybe obviously you're working here in Raleigh. Do you have any, you know, where you work now? Are there other venues too that you go, oh man, this is really cool? And even tell us a little bit about the venue you have where you are, and maybe things that we could do around that. I know right now it's a little different because of COVID, but in a normal scenario, hopefully
yes,
soon.
Definitely. I know, fingers crossed. I think the triangle is so awesome for art. It's one of the most creative and interesting and also most collaborative art locations that I have yet experienced in the US. So I would say definitely checking out a lot of the other local institutions like the Gregg Museum of Art at NC State, the Nasher at Duke, and the Ackland Art Museum at UNC. They're all fantastic. They all have different areas of expertise. Like the Nasher is also really great with contemporary art for things like textiles and maybe some printmaking and things like that. The Gregg is great. The Ackland has a really incredible print, prints and drawings collection, as well as Asian art. So a lot of these institutions, we kind of feed off of one another and we all have our own strengths. At the NCMA, we have an encyclopedic collection that stretches from ancient Egypt all the way through the modern day contemporary art. So we have a lot of areas of strength, I think, within that collection, but it's really amazing to know that we have more than 2000 years that can be represented in one space, especially in a city the size of Raleigh. It's not huge. And what we have at the NCMA is really amazing for our kind of town, our area. It's fantastic.
Good, so you mentioned in the triangle a few places, and then you've also talked about Paris. So whether you've seen it or not, what are some of your favorite locations or locations that you still have yet to visit that you'd really like to, say, bucket list locations within the whole world?
Oh my gosh, how much time do you have? I mean, I feel like there's so many places to go that have these iconic works of art. I mean, I really could talk for hours about what I want to see, but I would say the top ones right now, I really want to go to Mexico City. I've been one time, but unfortunately I didn't get to spend a whole lot of time looking at the art. I was there again on work. So unfortunately I was working the whole time. But I want to go see some of Frida Kahlo and Diego Rivera's works, especially Diego's murals that are in Mexico City. I would love to do that. There's a bunch of collections in Rome that I haven't yet visited that I would love to see as well. Some of my favorite institutions that I have been to, of course, there are incredible museums in New York. So just a quick hop and skip away from Raleigh. But I also love the Hermitage Museum in St. Petersburg in Russia. And also love the, oh goodness, there's a couple others in Spain that are fantastic too. I feel like it's really hard to beat Europe for a lot of really incredible museums.
So as I'm hearing you say all this stuff, and obviously just hearing you talk about it makes me go, wow, that sounds very interesting now, whereas I just never thought about it before. And while I know where the art museum is, I've walked out and where the different pieces of art are out in the back there. But if let's just say a person who's never really been into art, I'm almost wanting to find out, like, what's the baby steps for me? If I said, all right, I want to come to the art museum, kind of baby step me and say, hey, if you do this, you might not have any concept of art, but do this, and this might help you get into it, or this might help you get that understanding so you kind of grow in your interest around art.
Yes, I would say that art is just like anything else, like movies or music, in that you're going to be drawn to something probably very different than maybe the person next to you, or even somebody like your partner or your kids or a friend who you're going to the museum with. So I would say if you're entering an art museum for the first time and don't know what to do, just start by doing a quick loop. And in a place like the NCMA, it's easier to do that than at the Metropolitan Museum in New York, which is huge. I would just say, you know, look on a map or do a quick lap in the galleries just to see what area of the collection sounds most interesting to you. Like, are you excited more about the idea of photography as opposed to the idea of religious paintings from the 16th century in Europe, for example? Do you like paintings that are really bright and colorful? And if so, you might be more interested in contemporary art, something that's going on today. So I really just tell people that you don't have to understand everything, nor do you have to like everything. For me, I think the most important thing is just to look at something. And you'll start learning the more you look at art you'll find out what you're most intrigued by. And at that point, I would say, if you want to, then you can dive in and start learning more about the works by reading the wall text that's there, if there is any, or by looking up more information about a particular work or a particular artist. And you can do that sometimes just right there in the galleries on your phone, or even just take a picture of a work and then Google some information about it later. I think the most important part is just you looking and finding what is personally exciting to you. And sometimes that takes a little bit of time, and that is okay.
Yeah, that's, I think, understanding the story. If I was to get into art, I think it would be because I would want to understand the story. So like the way that you just told the story about the Mona Lisa, I had no idea. I knew what the Mona Lisa was, and I don't know why I knew it, but you told the story and then I'm like, oh, well, that makes a lot of sense. So for me, I think it would be understanding the story behind the art to actually get me into it.
Absolutely. And I think sometimes it can be difficult because we are in this phase in a lot of museums where we are really trying to limit the wall labels, for example. So like right now, how much information can you share with a viewer when you only have 100 words to do it? So we are actually relying on you as visitors quite a bit to bring your own thoughts and information. And that can be difficult when you're really looking for our help to give you that backstory. So by no means is it easy. It is definitely a challenge, but I think it is worth it to find out what you're most excited by.
Yeah. Yeah. So another topic here. So say we have someone, you know, that is just trying to get more art into their household. And I'm not saying, I know this is not what you do, but do you have any, say, local spots or places that you've gone that you really think they have they've got a good thing going, it's supporting local, any of those in the area? If someone's saying, I need to go get this or that, you know, what are some of your favorite spots in the area?
That is a really great question. I personally don't have a ton of like design kind of art experience, but for sure, I would say there are an incredible amount of local artists in the area, and many of them are involved with some of the smaller arts organizations. A lot of them are downtown Raleigh. So I'm thinking about Art Space, VAE, Anchor Light especially. They're artist studios and artist small places that do exhibitions as well. And sometimes in normal times, there's a lot of art openings that you can just go in and browse. And in a lot of cases, the artists will be there to talk about their work with you, which is something that artists love to do, to be able to make that personal connection. Right now, I'm not sure how many opportunities there are for that, but I do know that places like Anchor Light and Art Space are able to make appointments so that you can go in and physically look at art in a safe space. And I really think that that's the best thing, making that connection with the artists directly at these kind of smaller institutions. There's so many. I highly recommend looking them up.
So I know that prior to us recording the podcast, I was asking you about, are you working from home? You said, yeah, I've been working from home now throughout this whole situation with COVID. Mm-hmm. Is there, how's it working at the museums? Are the museums not open? Like what is it for your particular location? How are people dealing with that right now in the COVID scenario?
Yes. So the museum is open. I believe we opened up in September. It was either September or October. So we were really closed down for a good half of the year last year. Any of us who aren't involved in the front line, so visitor services, anybody but people like visitor services, ticket takers, the security guards, any of us who are able to be behind the scenes and do our work from home, we are requested to continue to do so until further notice, simply because the more people who are not at the museum, the more visitors can come in and see the works of art. So the museum collection is open and it is still free. Our permanent collection is free, but just for this period, it is still all timed tickets that you have to reserve online in advance. So it used to be that you could come into the permanent collection and just drop by and enter. Right now, that is not the case. And things are very limited in terms of who's allowed, how many people in the galleries. So it is very safe. It is very available to you. It just requires a little bit more planning right now.
Yeah. So with everyone having gotten so professional at using things like Zoom and, you know, WebEx and all these different softwares. I know I got an email the other day. I went to NC State, so I get their alumni email, and they are unveiling the remodeling of DH Hill, but they're doing it virtually. DH Hill was the big library that got very old and, you know, dusty, but they just remodeled it and they're doing a virtual unveiling. So I was wondering, you know, is that happening in the art world as far as being able to go see, you know, virtual tour or creations or anything like that?
Yes, definitely. I think that was a big deal for a lot of museums to all of a sudden switch over to doing, instead of all these live events, live tours, exhibition openings, things that we would normally do, almost everything got moved online. And so for those first 6 months of the COVID situation, we really did only online things. Now that the museum is open, you can still go physically into the galleries, but I believe all of our events are still online and virtual. But we've been able to transition into doing things like tours where a curator is holding kind of like a, not a GoPro, but one of those, basically like a selfie stick situation.
Yep. And it's okay to say selfie stick. People have
I know, right? It's pretty much what it is. So we're able to lead you into the galleries that way. So it's a safe, you know, contactless way to experience an exhibition. By no means is it the same. I mean, it's never the same to experience a work of art in person versus seeing it on a screen, but it's better than nothing. We've also had the opportunity to have a lot of virtual conversations with artists who've been represented in some of the exhibitions that we've had in the past year. Our curators, all of us, we've been doing talks and tours. We are also using this opportunity to kind of rethink the future of the museum and the direction in which we want to go in terms of acquiring works of art, showing exhibitions, and how we want to present our permanent collection ongoing to our visitors. So again, by no means has it been easy, but I think it's been a very fruitful time for us to really have this larger conversation about how we can move forward, how we can continue to talk about art and show things that people in the area might be interested in.
Very good. Well, I told you this before too, Laura in our office, she's the one who gave us your name and brought you up. And I tell you, I'm so glad she did. You make art interesting. So that's very good. And now as far as what you do, as far as you mentioned earlier that you have a podcast, could you just tell us a little bit about kind of the overview of your podcast, the name of it, just so people, I think you told me it's ArtCurious. So just like kind of what's the premise there? So if somebody wanted to go check it out, they would know what they're going to hear.
Sure. The podcast and the book have the same name, which is ArtCurious. And on the podcast, I tell what I call the stories of the unexpected, slightly odd, and strangely wonderful in art history. And what I basically mean by that is any sort of weird or funny or different story about art that you would not normally hear if you were taking an art course in college. So I try to toe the line between education and entertainment, because I tell stories that I hope would be fun and interesting for you, regardless of whether or not you like art, and that it can be for anyone. So ArtCurious, find it wherever you listen to podcasts, really.
Okay, good. And then the book, how can we get that? What's the best way for somebody to get the book?
Yes. So it came out last fall by Penguin Books. It's available pretty much wherever you buy a book. So Amazon, Barnes & Noble, Target, Walmart, your local bookstore. So if anybody wants signed or personalized copies, those are only available through Quail Ridge Books over in North Hills.
Okay, very nice. Well, Jennifer, it has been a wonderful conversation with you on this topic of art. You certainly have helped us and intrigued us. Merce and I just might become art connoisseurs right now.
I would love that. I hope so, but no pressure.
Well, thank you so much. We appreciate it. And I'm sure our listeners are going to enjoy the show. So thank you.
Thank you for having me on. This was a real pleasure.